Good morning, all.
Welcome to our first meeting for the year. We have our speaker today is going to be Chief White, who will be talking about seniors teaming up against fraud and scams. Chief?
Good morning. How are you? Some of you I've been with, so some of this that you'll hear probably for a second time. But since we are recording it, I want to be able to tell you a little bit about myself so the outside audience that may hear the DVD in the future would know who I am. I am the Chief of Police in Doylestown Township, and I have been a police officer, hard to believe, 37 years. And on January 19th, I passed an anniversary date that I became Chief of Police in Doylestown Township for 22 years. I am a graduate of St. Joseph's University, the FBI National Academy. My Board of Supervisors, Barbara Eisenhart's in the back, has allowed me in the past to serve as president, make my way up through the organizations. I've been president of the Bucks County Chiefs, the Pennsylvania Chiefs of Police, and I currently sit on the Board of Officers or Executive Committee of the International Association of Chiefs of Police that represent more than 22,000 chiefs in 104 countries. And the reason I say that is to give a little credibility to my remarks, because you could say that you've been a police officer for 37 years, but I've served as a police officer, I've served as a sergeant, I served 10 years as a lieutenant, and as I said, 22 years as chief of police. All of us know that in our lifetime that the credibility that we have is because of the life's experience that we all have. And my remarks are, as Bill said, are guided towards seniors teaming up against fraud and crime. And the reason why you have to team up against fraud and crime is because we need to protect each other, and we need to guide everybody through a very difficult time period. If you are, your money is stolen, or your bank accounts and everything that you've spent your entire life building up, your good credit, is destroyed, then you could be shattered and you could be penniless and you could be in a very difficult position. You wouldn't think that there is pure evil out there or people that would take every penny that's in your bank account. But the fact of the matter is that we see that day in and day out, that there is pure evil out there that would do that. When I first came to Doylestown Township, I actually walked through this front door here in this fall of 1973. And when I was a new police officer in Doylestown Township, quite honestly, I was actually involved in public safety. Not that, because I'm old now and I'm a chief of police, but what I mean that is, if there was the local kid doing vandalism, or the local drunk was driving down the roadway, or somebody stole something out of the backyard, you really felt that you were actually involved in public safety in Doylestown Township. It was a kind of, even 1973, it was kind of an Ozzie and Harriet type of setup, that really the criminals that were out there didn't travel. Nowadays, they travel not only because of the mobility of cars, but they travel because they have the internet, the phone service, and everything that they do. In those days, you could have your a wallet stolen out of your purse in the Acme Market or the grocery store because somebody distracted you and the other person picked it out of your pocketbook. Or you could be getting onto the train in Doylestown and getting on the train and somebody bumped into you in a pickpocket in the old-fashioned way, just pulled your wallet out of your back of your pants and took it and went away. Well, the truth of the matter is now the distraction or the bump could be coming from Eastern Europe, Canada, Nigeria, anywhere in the United States, and you're not going to know it. Just as the person that got on the train and had their wallet stolen in 1973, you're not going to know that this is going to occur, because they do it so surreptitiously that you're not going to know that your good credit and your money is gone. There's been a couple scams that in looking up this morning to talk to you, some of the ones that are being done. You heard about the stimulus checks and the stimulus money that you would be able to have. Sure enough, there's a stimulus scam. The FBI is warning seniors that either by the internet or by a phone call, you could be contacted and say that you are entitled to a stimulus check. Just give me your information and we'll get it out to you. Or we would ask you to be able to give me your information. If you send us $15 or $25, you actually get a bigger stimulus check. and some seniors would do that, and they would give the information out, or they would just ask for your banking information and go in right into your bank accounts. The other one that has become popular is the census. Now, what would you think would be evil about the census? There's a scam now that's going around saying it's the senior census survey. And what that is they are contacting you either by phone or on the internet, and they're saying that because, and they're complimenting you, they want to tell you because of your long life you have a little more experience than the younger people that are going to answer the census information. So what we would like you to do is help us, because what we're going to do is gather information and we're going to give it to the President of the United States. So if you could answer these questions, we would appreciate it. And by the way, in order that other seniors just like you, don't you feel good that we ask you those questions? That other seniors just like you, so they could answer these questions, if you could give us a donation of $15 or $25, we'll be able to send this questionnaire out to more seniors. And guess what? The President of the United States will hear more information from all of you. So what happens? They send in the money. What happens? They say, or you can make a donation. Just give us your credit card information and you can make a donation right to this fund. Isn't the census in 2010 something that you want to do? And unfortunately, seniors or anybody, I'm not picking on seniors, there's everybody, every imaginable type of person. We just had a young couple out on Swamp Road that fell to one of the scams where they received a check in the mail saying that they wanted them to do part of the business, and could they mail back they can keep $500 or the $2,500 check, but we're sorry, we mailed the check too big, so if you could mail the $2,000 back to us, and they did. And about a week later, the bank told them that the original check was no good, and they wanted their $2,500 back. And of course, that's a real tragedy. The one that I think is one of the most insidious ones is called the grandparent scam. And the grandparent scam is played like this. You'll receive a call about 10:30 at night or late at night, and they'll say, if it's a woman answering, Grandma. And if it's a man answering, say, Grandpa. And they say, what? Is this Joey? The caller has no idea who your grandchildren are, but they go, yes, it's Joey. Say, Grandpa, I got arrested for DUI in Canada, and they're holding me in a jailing cell, and I'm only allowed to about have a minute phone call, so I got to give you the information. My bail money is $3,400, and if you go to MoneyGram or Western Union, you need to do it to Montreal, and they'll pick it up and they'll post bail and I'll get out of bail. Please, Grandma, Grandpa, make sure you do that. So what does Grandma and Grandpa do? Next morning they get up, go get $3,400, go right to the Western Union and send it right up to Montreal. And the difficult part about this is that the group that has been doing this is so bad that they call back the next day and they say, I'm sorry, the bail wasn't $3,400, it was actually $5,000, so we need to make up the difference. You need to send another $2,000 some up to us. And what does Grandma and Grandpa do? They don't want Joey sitting in a prison up in Canada in a foreign country. They will send the money, the bail money. They then turn around, and about a week later they call, and it's either a female or a male saying they're from the Federal Bureau of Investigation and they've been trailing this criminal group that's surrounding Montreal, or they have a Canadian that's involved in the scam, and they'll say male or female. And the worst one that I heard of was a female that did this to a woman in Lancaster. But they call up and they say, we're from the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, and you know, and you can see yourself on the phone standing straight, you can see the red uniform and you're saluting them and everything, and they say that we're trailing this organized crime group in Montreal, and we have three Western Union offices completely surround it. But what we need is for you to actually send the money up there, and we'll intercept it, and we're gonna arrest a lot of very bad people that have taken advantage of senior citizens all over the United States. And what do? They go to the Western Union office and mail the money up. Well, the one that I said from Lancaster was so bad, they had this woman thinking that she was arresting people all over the Montreal area, and they actually got her for over $40,000 that she kept emailing the money. She's dealing with the FBI. She's dealing with the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. Certainly, they wouldn't be something that would be illegal. So the grandparent scheme and scam has been something that's been unbelievably bad for seniors to be able to be involved in. And, you know, one of the things that, you know, you want to tend to look back on a time that was not as dangerous and a time that was not as significantly problematic as far as somebody stealing your money. Who would think that somebody would be so evil that they would take a senior citizen that's like living in Grundy Hall, like my mom? She passed away a couple years ago, but my mother entered every contest, entered everything. Anybody that called her or sent her something, she was going to win. So she would send off the money. One day I was there and I got a call. It was a gentleman with a foreign accent. I'm not going to say what country, that he was selling her Canadian lottery tickets, and could she send in the money? And I said, sir, I'm the chief of police in Doylestown Township. Do not call this number again. So I hung up, went away. The next week I came back. What was on the table? The Canadian lottery tickets. He called back as soon as I left. He knew I couldn't stay there all day. And so the people are there are really very, very evil that would do that. What is the problem that we have now? A lot of people are looking for a job. They want to add a couple dollars to their pocket. So what they do is if they have if they're on the internet, they'll get an email that'll say, if you want to start your own home business, what we need you to do is we have people, we are an auction house in, say, Eastern Europe somewhere, or even London or Paris or wherever the line is. And what we cannot do is we can't accept the people who purchase our items. We can't accept their checks. But if you can, because from outside of the London or they're outside of the United States, if you can receive their checks, forward the money to me in London, you get to keep 25% of the check. And you wouldn't think, well, it has to be legitimate. They contacted me in my home. I'm going to get a check. The bank certainly is going to know whether the check that I receive is a legitimate check, and they flood you with checks. There was a gentleman that lived in our township on Westaway Lane that did this $150,000 check, and he's looking at it, holy mackerel, 25% of a $150,000 check. This is awesome. Deposits it, forwards the check to the people. And of course, days later, they find out that the original check was counterfeit and the money that you have forwarded is not real money, and you could be out of it. And I go back to the idea is that how could anybody be that evil to steal off of anybody, and not only that, to steal every penny that they have in their life? Well, the other target that you have is your good credit. You know that when you were in high school, you got a job, whether it was at the fast food store or a waitress or at a car wash, and you started making a little money. But really what you were doing was building up your good name and your good credit. And then as you went through high school and college, you got other jobs, and then you had a career, and then what you have done for your whole life is build up the good name of Steve White. And this is something that you have great pride in, and you're looking now to relax for the rest of your life and live off that good name. And you have a little nest egg that you're going to be able to live on. And you would think that people wouldn't steal that. Well, the problem with once you fall victim to any one of the scams, or once you fall victim to somebody misusing your credit card information, or just say you answered an ad that said, we're from the United States Census. You got in the mail, you got the most official looking letterhead from the Census Bureau saying, we want you to help us. And you feel like, you know, again, I'm an important person. I'm going to help them. So you answer the information. And then you think, well, I'm involved with the Senior Citizen Taskforce, or I'm involved at the Senior Center. You know, there's all kinds of people that are really great people that maybe if they answer this questionnaire, they'll be able to help out the President of the United States, because as we know, there's a lot of problems in the United States and we need to help out. So what you do is you put your information in there, and then all of a sudden, not only is your bad name gone, but a lot of your life savings are gone. and you have to figure out yourself, how do you recover yourself? When I told you that when I first came here, that I was involved in actually public safety because there was, and when I came here, every house may have had one car. Now every house has three and four cars, and we won't go into the speed in the neighborhoods or the problems that that creates. But what I want to create the picture in your mind is it was a much simpler time, and people didn't have all the contacts that you could have involved in identity crime and things like that. Well, if somebody steals your good name and steals your money, the police departments in 1973, even Doylestown Township, when I was hired, I was actually the fourth full-time officer hired. We had about 8,000 residents when I was hired. And this isn't a push for the Central Bucks Regional Police Department, but yes, it is. There are 42 separate police departments in Bucks mm-hmm. County. In Pennsylvania, there are 1,210 police departments. We have more police departments than any other state in the nation. And if our police departments went from four, like in Doylestown Township, to the 21 officers that we have now, and all these police departments are all little police departments that are around there, and you are sitting in your house on Pebble Hill Road, and you realized, I gave my information to somebody in Eastern Europe, and they're cleaning out my bank account. I'm sorry, Pat, I didn't mean Pebble Hill Road. We'll pick another road, sorry. But you're sitting in your house and your good name has been damaged, and you're thinking, how am I gonna defend myself? How am I gonna recover to my pre-crime status? And then you think, if you're knowledgeable enough about police departments, oh my God, there's all these little police departments all over the place. How are they gonna recover my name back from Eastern Europe? Well, one of the things that the Doylestown Township allowed me to do, being involved with the International Association of Chiefs of Police, I was chosen. I had a three-year program that just expired at the end of 2008, where Bank of America came to the International Association of Chiefs of Police, and they wanted us to go out and actually do four things. One, train police chiefs how to train their officers to do identity crime investigation. Two, restore victims to their pre-crime status. Three, help investigators understand how they can go about getting the information from the banks. Did you ever try to get something from the bank? It's almost impossible at times, but there are ways to get it. So we were training the investigators how to do that. And four is how to train the bank to cooperate with law enforcement to help people recover to their pre-crime status. And that's very important to be able to do. But as I traveled all over the United States and made these presentations to different groups of chiefs of police, you realize they don't know how to do this. If the law enforcement doesn't know how to do it, how is somebody on Pebble Hill Road going to recover their name from Eastern Europe? So what we did is we actually went out, and actually the Pennsylvania Commission on Crime and Delinquency did the same thing, and the Municipal Police Officers Education and Training Commission did the same thing, where we were teaching police officers. The very first thing we need to train police is when someone comes into their station and says that their wallet was stolen at the Montgomery Mall, and the thefts occurred at Oxford Valley Mall or Neshaminy Mall, but I live in Doylestown Township, what do I do? In an uninformed day, the police officers would go, You got to report the wallet stolen over in Montgomery Township, and you got to go down and tell the police in the area of Oxford Valley Mall that it was used. Well, that's not true. Actually, the legislature have passed a law, and it has been reproduced federally and also at the state, that the jurisdiction that the person lives in, where they reside, has the authority to prosecute the case. So what we were doing is we were educating the police officers to learn how to do that. The very first thing they need to do is to take the report. I mean, our mantra all across the United States was take the report, because the most important thing that you need to do is give a copy of the police report to the victim of identity crime immediately. Don't say, I'll give it to you in a couple days. I can guarantee you that if you talk to most police departments, the last thing they're going to give up is their investigative report. But under identity crime, they need to do that immediately. And we started a procedure in Doylestown Township where we taught the officers just do the who, what, where, when, and how. Do it on the front page of the report and immediately give it to the victim. Second thing you need to do is to get an affidavit saying that you're actually the victim of an identity crime, you reported it to the police, and you are going to cooperate with the investigation. The Federal Trade Commission in 1998 was charged with doing a couple different things. One was educating the public on consumer crimes, and now in the last 3 or 4 years, it really is identity crime that they're really primarily getting involved in. And how to recover your name. Online, you can get a model affidavit that you would put with the police report. Because here's what has to happen. You need to go, every one of our knuckleheads in Doylestown Township goes right to Home Depot and opens up a $1,500 credit, or they do something right in Montgomery Mall. Well, what people don't realize is every time you go to a cash register, your picture's being taken. They actually look right up at the picture, and you look at them, and so we can get the transactional information if we have the permission of the victim. But more importantly, the victim, by law, is the one that has to go to Home Depot and say, I was defrauded. Here's a copy of my police report, and here's a copy of the affidavit. Do not use the original ones that we gave you, because you have to do this for each one of the businesses that would be involved. Then they have to contact Sears and say Radio Shack down in the Oxford Valley Mall. They could do this over the phone and find the fraud departments and say, that wasn't me. I didn't do that. They need to go online and check with one of the three credit bureaus to get a copy of the credit report. One of the things I enjoy asking any audience that I go in front of is, when is the last time that you personally looked at your own credit report? All right. A lot of times people, you'll see their face, they'll go, well, I've never looked at my credit report. Well, you need to look at your credit report. Twice, the chief of police in Doylestown Township's credit card was compromised. Twice in the last couple of years. And so you have to be very careful. You have to review your credit report and make sure all the purchases or all the new credit lines that were opened up by you, and none of it is false. Because what you have to do is, if something is on there that's not yours, you immediately have to contact the credit bureau and say, the open line of credit at Home Depot that was opened up on December 24th is not me, and you need to send a copy of the affidavit and a photocopy of the affidavit and a photocopy of the police report. And you go down the list, and each one of the businesses, you need to do that. Unfortunately, the next thing they'll do is open up new credit cards and change the address to some place they can get to. And they'll do that and run up all the different credit cards that you do have. As you see, as we talk about this morning, if you're not protecting yourself, or if you hadn't looked at your credit report, you're getting deeper and deeper and deeper. The victim of this identity crime is actually getting deeper and deeper and deeper into a problem. What I tried to tell them, some of you that know me know that I have a real joy in running. I really like to do running events, and it's a lot of fun. Of course, my wife looks at me like I'm completely insane, because yes, we do a running thing in Tyler Park on Sunday mornings through the winter, and even in the snow and everything, it's fun. But I always tell everybody, recovering your good name is like doing a marathon. 26 miles is a very long time. Not very long distance. I remember talking to the kids at Kutz, and they were saying to me, well, how long? I told them I had done several marathons. And they said, well, how long is a marathon? And I said, well, we'll do this. We'll go right out the front door of Kutz, go down on 611, and we're going to jog down to the city hall in Philadelphia. And they look at it and they go, what are you, nuts? Well, you're actually 2 miles short, so it is a little bit longer than that. But it's an ordeal. It really is. Recovering your good name is one of the worst ordeals, one of the worst physically draining things that you will go through in your life. And one of the things that I want to do, and that's what the program did in the United States, was to teach the policemen that when they have a resident coming in, they have to be extremely patient, and they have to be as helpful as possible to tediously teach the resident how to restore their good name. And what we tell everybody is to get a copybook. And in there, I don't know about you, sometimes I can't remember what I did yesterday. And if you're trying to recover your good name and you're contacting this business and you're talking to that person and you're talking to this fraud department or that security agency or that salesperson, I'm never going to remember any of that information. So we tell them to get a copybook and actually take notes. On this day, I talked to Sears and I talked to this person, and this is what they told me to do. On this day, I sent a copy of the affidavit and the police report to Radio Shack, and they told me what to do. Because at the end, hopefully there'll be a successful prosecution, and we'll be able to find someone that's responsible for the crimes. Several of my officers, and I'm very proud of them, have tediously gone about all over the crimes occurring all over the place, and we've built some good prosecutions, and I'm very happy that they take the time to do that. But if I go back to the idea that there's all these small police departments, one of the things, just as an historical thing, a story, Bill always likes stories about history. William Penn, when he established the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, wanted the citizens to be able to reach out and touch their own elected officials. Some of the mayors that are in the office in the audience today probably wouldn't want that all the time because sometimes they're angry. But that's why he created small boroughs, small townships, small cities. And that's why we have so many municipalities throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. But if you fragment law enforcement like that, how effective are we to be able to go against people that are doing crimes? You remember when I told you when I first became a police officer, I was actually just involved with a kid in the neighborhood doing vandalism or the local drunk or something that occurred right in my neighborhood. But now we could have people in Montana creating crimes of identity crime in Doylestown Township or Eastern Europe or Nigeria or Canada or anywhere in the world because they have access to you. Unfortunately, either by mail or on the internet, your identifying information is out there. And we just read in the paper yesterday where Warwick Township, the best thing I heard about the case where they arrested the people for stealing the mail was the resident promptly called the police. Invariably, we'll get to things and we'll talk to the neighbors and they'll say, yeah, that was really suspicious. We saw this, this, and this. Why didn't you call? You know, but they called the police right away. And what we need to do is get law enforcement to be able to understand their job, even if they don't make an arrest in the case, their primary job is to restore their resident victim of identity crime back to their pre-crime status. And as I told you how tedious it was, I don't know about you, but if I told you to contact all these businesses and do all this thing, you would get frustrated at being able to do that. And then when the business hangs up on you or says, no, you don't call me, you call that person or you call this, you know, and then you go, all I want to do is get my money back and get my good name back. Well, the police should be encouraging the victims of identity crime to be patient. It might take a long time, but we're here to help you. Because I'll tell you what, I meet more people in the Acme or more people in the YMCA than you could possibly imagine. And that's what I tell police chiefs. If your officers are not responsive to your own residents, how popular do you think that you're going to be with your board of supervisors or borough council? But if your officers are going out of their way to help people be restored to their pre-crime status, how grateful are they going to be to your municipal police department that, yeah, I know they couldn't arrest the guy in Eastern Europe, but you know what? Step by step by step over the last 6 months, they helped me regain my good name. They recovered my credit report. They recovered some of the money that would be involved in it because when you challenged it on your credit report, the company put the money back on out of your credit card. You were able to challenge that and they put it back in because you knew what you're doing. Well, the same thing is with police departments. We got to make sure that they know what they're doing and they have the ability to be able to do that. One of the last topics that I'd like to talk about, and then we'll open it up to questions and hopefully have some questions, is people often ask that if some solicitor contacts me and I don't want to talk to them, you know, how do I get on the do not call list? Well, I have some paperwork up here. The Pennsylvania Attorney General's office does have a do not call list, and you can just register online or by phone not to call. But you need to do that every 5 years. If you said, well, I did that years ago. Well, I was preparing for this and I looked it up and I went, ooh, I did that more than 5 years ago, so I put my name back in. Or through the Federal Trade Commission, you can register on the National Do Not Call list, where they would not call you. Solicitors are hardcore salesmen sometime, or door-to-door people that come into your community. We are relentless in the police department, and I can say that all the police departments in the area are the same way, that if somebody wants to come and solicit in your neighborhood and go door-to-door, we actually fingerprint and photograph them and run a criminal history record on them. And we go over the criminal history record to make sure the most inappropriate people do not come into their community. And you'd be surprised at some of the people that apply for soliciting permits in Doylestown Township. But they're supposed to display prominently the municipal soliciting permit. You should see that. And if you do not see it, you need to call the local police. Often as I travel around and talk to different groups, people will tell me that, well, I didn't want to bother you. You know, just because somebody came and tried to sell me 10 magazines and I didn't want any of them, you know, but you have a lot of better things to do, so I didn't want to bother the police. I speak for all the chiefs of police when I tell you this. I don't care if everyone calls us 10 times a day, because it's the one time that they don't call that they fall victim to something that could really be harmful to them. So we want you to call the police. We have some of the nicest men and women in our police department. We have two women and 19 men in the police department. In fact, one of my officers the other day, a woman called up and she was hopping mad at me. She was saying that the police officer came to my house and he asked me my age and I didn't want to tell him my age. And Officer Sean McGee turned around and says, well, ma'am, it's just part of the report. And she says, okay, but I'm 82, and I don't want people to know I'm 82. And he went, 80's the new 50. So she was on the phone to me saying, Officer McGee's the greatest police officer in the face of the earth. He made me feel wonderful. You want the police officers in the community that everybody that sees them, that they will be approachable. One of the things, and it's hard to believe, but one of the things that make me the happiest is if I am at the Y and I'm on the treadmill or something, somebody actually comes up to me. Or I'm at the lunch meat counter at the grocery store, and they'll come up to me and say, I just have a little question. Because people, for some reason, don't want to call the police department. But yet, if they bump into you, they can ask you the little question. Well, often the little question is a big problem. And you want to encourage them. If one thing, if anybody that hears the presentation today is, call the police. I don't care what the question is. A lot of the questions that we have nothing to do with law enforcement. I have a new police clerk, and the other day I was sitting in my office right here and I was listening to her talk, and she spent about 3 or 4 minutes on the phone with whoever was calling her, very step by step helping them do something. And I came out of the office and I said, you know, that had nothing to do with police work. But what is the best thing you could do for somebody on a Tuesday morning? Is to help them whatever they're going to do. And I said, that's a great job. That's what I want the people in Doylestown Township that work for Doylestown Township to be able to do. Because our job is to be the facilitator. Our job is to point people in the right direction. And I really, really think that that's so important to everybody. So with the scams and the frauds and everything that you could have out there, there really is a danger. We are not living in Ozzie and Harriet land. We are not living in Doylestown Township in 1973. There are evil people that will take every dime, every good part of your good name, and completely destroy it. And you have to know that and what we need to do. If you think that, I mean, one of the problems with our age group and people that are older, is that they were brought up in a generation that you never asked for help. You had to do everything on your own. You survived a war. You survived being able to overcome many obstacles that some of the younger people will never face and will never understand. So if somebody took something from me, like all my money, how could I possibly tell somebody that? Or how could I possibly contact the Doylestown Township Police to tell them that? Well, what we need to do, as Bill said, the title of the presentation today is Seniors Team Up Against Fraud and Scams. we're a team, we're together. Now that you know how to do different things, you need to make sure all of your friends and anybody that hears this presentation the same way knows that they can depend on each other to protect each other. If you see some of your friends sending money off to contests or sweepstakes, or they're going to win, none of it's real. What did your mom say when you were a little kid? Nothing comes free. Nothing comes free. That's absolutely the truth. You're not going to get a phone call that says you won $150,000 in the foreign lottery, and all you need to do is send $5,000 to show good faith that you can pay the taxes on the $150,000, and don't run down to your bank and send it. We had a Doylestown Township resident that he sent multiple times $2,000, $3,000, $2,500 to win the $150,000. I put an article in the Intel that warned people, do not respond to this. The grocery store north of 313 is in Plumstead Township. I got a call from the clerk in the grocery store. She said, Chief, I know we're not in Doylestown Township, but I read your article this morning. There's a gentleman here that is demanding to wire $2,000, and I know it has to be something that you talked about in the article. I ran up there. I called Chief Dwayne Hassenauer for Plumstead, and I told him to meet me there. I went up there, went in the door. Who was it? But our township resident that had already sent off $12,000 to win the $150,000. And he looked at me, and I told him, I said, it's a fake. It's a fraud. And he looked at me, and he says, I won the $150,000. And I said, no, you didn't. You lost $12,000, and you're lucky that she didn't let you do the other $2,000. He left the supermarket angry at me, angry at the clerk, because he won the $150,000, and we were stopping him. But we protected him. So when I tell you you're on the senior team to help against fraud and scams, you're on the starting lineup. And what I need you to do is go out and help protect your friends. Because obviously, after you heard this, you're not going to get involved in becoming a victim of any of this stuff. But what you need to do is be able to go out and help your friends. So what I'd like to do as we tie up is to ask anybody that has any questions. You know, one of the funny things is, no matter how old you get, you know, when we were in school, if we could choose to sit, everybody sat in the back. And I don't want to say that you're still doing that, but you're all sitting in the back. So since you did that, what I want you to do is actually ask me some questions. You know, go ahead.
Chief, isn't it a rule of thumb or a safe thing to say that, I guess crime is a growth industry, but that when you get a call or an internet message, that there's no government agency, federal, state, or local, and there's no bank that will ever ask you personal information by phone or on an internet. And that is,
that's
that
absolutely the truth. I'm glad that you asked that question. There is never a legitimate governmental agency or business that will ever send you an email saying put your personal identifying information, like your name, date of birth, or Social Security, or banking information. If you do not know who you are talking to, hang up. And one of the things that I just want to find the one, if you get email messages that you think are suspicious that deal with money and things like that, you can forward the email message. Don't open it. Just forward it to phishing@irs.gov, phishing@irs.gov. Do not click on it. Do not open it. Even if you get something that you think may be legitimate, don't open up any of the attachments, because what it could do is put different spyware or different bad things on your computer that would root through it until they get your personal information, and then you're gone. You wouldn't think, how do people be that smart that they can do that from across the country? They're that smart, and they can do that from across the country. So be very careful. But that's it. That's a great question.
Yes, Chief. I was wondering, do you have the training outline in print someplace?
You know, this is almost the Libby White's, we're not related, but she set me up to say, yes, I do. Libby, it's actually right over there on the table before you leave are actually the step-by-step things to recover your good name and identity crime. It's almost like, we set that up. That was great.
No, mine.
Yeah, there's a lot of good things out there, you know, easy things that people that can do that they don't know. And it surprises me that there's not enough education, or there's, well, obviously there's never enough, you know, but, you know, just like getting your free credit report. You know, if you go to freecreditreport.com, you're going to go through a labyrinth of stuff to get a free credit report. You go to annualcreditreports.com.
I'm glad you brought that up.
It's there. It's easy to get to, and you can do that three times a year. One, you know, you can use one agency three, every year, so that's every 4 months you can do a different one.
Can I just stop you there?
Sure.
You can continue and keep going on. Freecreditreport.com is a commercial business. You do not want to go on that one. Annualcreditreport.com is through the Federal Trade Commission. Remember I told you the Federal Trade Commission was charged with educating the public? www.annualcreditreport.com. Now, they are going to put you to the three credit bureaus. The three credit bureaus are commercial businesses. They will ask you to put your credit card information in there. You do not have to do that. Just do not, because they're going to sell you a product. They're going to say, well, how about for $7 a month, we'll keep an eye on your credit report, or we'll protect it, or we'll do something. You don't have to do that. Just decline that, and you can print the credit report right from your computer. It's a great, great point. Go ahead. I'm sorry for interrupting.
You can dispute online anything yes. that's not there also. But also, if people were to know, hey, you get an email, you know, to click on a link. Don't click on the link. Go to the website. The old fashioned, you know, the find that website yourself. That way you make sure that you're not clicking on a link that may be a fake link. And the third one, if you're going to pay for something on the internet, pay by credit card,
right.
Not debit card, because debit card, they can again wipe out your account.
But know who you're dealing with online. Yeah. Absolutely know who you're dealing with online, because there are people that would do that. Bill, any, go ahead.
Chief White, related issue. Have you ever had situations where seniors have felt that they've been victims of abuse of powers of attorney, where people have
great,
used...
Great question. Yes, absolutely. I mean, they will be people that will contact you and say, guess what, you need a living will. You ought to do the living will. Come to us and we'll develop the living will. And they'll do exactly like that. All you have to do is give us a power of attorney, and we'll do the living will for you. But what they're doing is you're getting the power of attorney to go get your bank accounts and to get your credit card. So you have to be very careful. That's a great question.
What about family members, like children or other people who have used powers of attorney to wipe out bank accounts and things like that? Have you ever had that?
Yeah, unfortunately, we have dealt with families that are torn apart because the youngest or oldest or one of the people are a power of attorney. One of the most evil diseases that have come upon us is dementia. And in dementia, somebody in the family has to take care of the victim of the dementia. Fortunately, in my family, my mom had 5.5 years of dementia. She used to think I was my brother every time I visited her, but that's okay, that's another story. But my brother is an attorney, and he did get power of attorney. But there are families that no one's trained in it. And sometimes they're not necessarily out for the good of the victim of dementia or the family, and they will do exactly that. They'll use the power of attorney. If someone asks you to sign a power of attorney, you need to speak to an attorney or someone knowledgeable about what the power of a power of attorney is. It is incredibly powerful. Do not do that. Great question.
If your credit card company has proactively contacted you about possible fraud and it ended up being accurate and they're handling it, do you still need to go to your local police department to file a report?
Good question. Absolutely, because one of the first things they're going to ask you by law is a copy of the police report. You have to get a copy of the police report because that shows you're willing to assist in the investigation. That's what the federal law says. So you have to get it. You should go to the police department to make that report. It's very important. Hold on, just one of my fine elected officials has a question. I don't want to ignore her. Go ahead, Barb.
Actually, I just wanted to make a comment about it relative to your power of attorney thing. One of the things that a very good friend who's an attorney had recommended to us a long time ago was that if you want one of your children to be power of attorney, make them co-power of attorney with your attorney, so that you can actually do that with your attorney in concert with each other, so that even if they tried to do something, and even if it's your own family, you'd like to think that they would never do anything that would be harmful to you or disruptive to your finances. You can do co-power of attorneys with a family member and an attorney so that your child or relative can't do anything without the other written consent of the attorney.
Okay, in case that wasn't picked up on the microphone, because there's hardly any above you, is if you're going to have a power of attorney, you do a co-power attorney with your attorney, with one of your children or whoever would do that. That's a great point. The other thing that you would bring up that she brings up is do it when you are of sound mind. You know, pre-plan a lot of the things that you need to do so you make sure you're protected.
And one other thing, when you were talking about the scams and frauds, I believe I showed it to Bill, and we were going to post it on the website, but I have to apologize. I think the site was down at the time, so it didn't get posted. But we got a thing in the mail from the U.S. State Department that said that you're required by law to have a certified copy of your deed, and for a mere $65, if you mail this in, we'll send you a certified copy of your deed. It sounds harmless, but most people don't realize they can get a free copy at the courthouse. But that's recent, and that I know other people who got the same paperwork.
Actually, it's legitimate. The question was that if you get in the mail a certified copy of your deed, for only $45, they'll get it for you. Well, you send it off to Illinois, they'll actually get it for you, and they'll mail it to you. Well, it only costs either free or $5. So it's a business. It's a commercial business to be able to do that. Okay, ignored you long enough.
Anybody can do to protect the credit. It's real simple. They could put a fraud alert on, which means that anytime a new line of credit is opened, the creditor has to call a phone number to verify. So they have to contact the person that owns that information first.
What he's saying is, if any time you're defrauded or anything, that you should, when you contact the credit bureau and saying that's not mine, you request that a fraud alert be put on there. There can be a limited fraud alert or an extended fraud alert, but both of them make sure that if the bad people then go to another area and try to open up another line of credit, the fraud alert is on there, and they'll know not to open up the second line of credit, and it's supposed to protect the victim.
Second one is the credit.
I got to ask you, what is your line of work? Because you're very informative.
I'm a mortgage broker.
Okay.
So I'm familiar with a lot of credit issues. The second one, which is great for elderly people who don't...
Well, we don't call them elderly people. We call them the senior
team. I'm sorry.
Or they'll really hurt you on the way out the door.
I'm
the door.
Biologically gifted. Okay.
But we have three holding cells, but you can be protected in one of them.
The second one is the credit freeze, where if you're not planning on opening up any more credit lines in the future, you can actually totally prevent anybody from opening up credit in your name.
Hey, what he's talking about is a credit freeze, and that is exactly that. If you feel like I have my credit cards that I'm going to use, I don't want to open any line of credit, I'm not interested in Home Depot, I'm not interested in Sears, I'm not interested in Bonfire, I'm not interested in any other credit card, if you put a credit freeze on your credit report, that will stop anybody from opening it up, and it's a very good point. There's a lot of the things in the identity crime thing that I was going to talk about, but they said half an hour, and I think I'm way over that. So, Bill?
Steve?
Oh, one more question.
Two quick ones. Number one, when you said if somebody calls you and you think it's a scam,
right,
and you get that telephone number, should you call the police and give them to them?
Yes. I mean, I when I say call me 10 times a day, really. I mean, if you think that it's suspicious, call the police department and we'll try to investigate it.
You can get the telephone number.
Right. Well, a lot of times the photo ID or the phone ID will come right up on your thing.
I'm saying it stays there when they hang up on our system. Okay, and the other item which verifies what you said is sometimes it takes a long time to correct things. For example, I was sick at the state meet May a year ago, and there were three bills that I got. One in the hospital, which I had to pay part of it, an ambulance, which I thought was high, and I went to my insurance company, which they took some of it off, and that was covered. And then the people in the ambulance kept calling me, and they were going to get companies to have me pay this. And what happened is I kept calling them, and I would tell the people that I talked to, I want your name, the name of the company, and I said, if you hurt my credit rating, my lawyers will come after you. And what happened is they didn't go after my credit rating, and the whole part came down that the people filed the wrong number to get the insurance. And it finally was settled this coming January. And they paid half of it, and they still came after me. They paid half of it in October, and they still came after me. And I called them and got everything straightened out. And here, some of the people you deal with in businesses or whatever it is, don't do their work to the fullest. Yeah. And that can hurt your credit rating. And the only thing is you got to just stay with it. As you said, sometimes it takes
some time. Actually, Ernie brings up a very good point, because I didn't cover this. If the bad debt that you didn't open up yourself is handed over to a debt collector, and that debt collector starts hounding you down, you contact the debt collector, you give them a copy of the police report, a copy of the affidavit, and by law, they're required to stop hounding you down and to take it off and to contact the credit bureaus and to assist you in taking that item off your credit report. Sometimes the debt collectors, because of the nature of business, they're dealing with people that are desperate, that try to avoid them. They get very frustrated in their business, so they're not necessarily the most friendly people to call you when they're calling you, and they will hunt you down. And so even if you have something legitimate, like that's not my debt, there are steps that you have to take. If one thing that I need to impress upon you about the whole presentation is the way that the state law and the federal law are written, is the victim of the identity theft has to do all the work. The victim of the identity theft has to do all the work, but they can be assisted by law enforcement, and that's what we're here for. One last question.
The consolidation of police forces, do you feel that this will go forward, or is there a lot of resistance to that? Is there an efficiency or money gain there?
No, we're real early in the stage, the thing. What ended up happening, and this has nothing to do with the identity crime things, but we're very, very early in the stages of considering this. The chief in Warwick and the chief in Doylestown Township, me, are going to retire within 2 years. And if we're going to retire, let's use the opportunity to study this. We're not saying that it's going to be a something that we'll definitely do. But here's the point that I like. I believe that regionalization is going to eventually occur. And if it's going to eventually occur, we all should be on the ground floor setting the rules to make sure we have the finest regional police department that there is. And that's why I want to advocate for it. Because if you're talking about, I said that there are 42 police departments in Bucks County, and you could say, well, it's a big county. There's almost 700,000 residents in the county. There are 9 separate police departments in the Central Bucks School District. To me, that's absurd that there are 9 separate police departments in the Central Bucks School District. But you could say it's a big area. It's probably conservatively over $30 million a year of tax dollars. So what's the best thing that we could do? Get the best, most effective law enforcement agency to serve the residents of Central Bucks area, and that would be a Central Bucks Regional Police Department. And that's what I would advocate, because I think it's going to happen in the future. We need to be on the ground floor setting the rules to make sure it's first class, it has the best procedures, has the best personnel, and that we make it work. And that's why I'm for it. But that's off the subject of this. Bill?
Thank you, Steve. And, thank you very much. Get you back again.
Sounds good. Thank you very much.